I love you, Barb. I love your smile. I do. Okay. The Sermon on the Mount is a brilliant message designed to launch a movement in the face of great opposition. Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount are not these happy little esteem boosters. Okay, they are dangerous, and they are spoken early on in his ministry. In the Sermon on the Mount, as I've mentioned to you, Jesus was speaking to people on the mountainside who were seen as the dregs of society, and Jesus begins that sermon with that series of beatitudes, right? Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, blessed are those who are persecuted, which we looked at last week. And right after these beatitudes, though, Jesus makes a critical shift in his preaching. He gives the people an identity to claim. Here it is. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. Jesus is saying to them, you are the salt of the earth. These words carried great weight 2,000 years ago. I'm not sure what kind of weight they carry today. So I'm going to spend some time, okay, looking at you'll be wondering, where am I going? And I don't know where I'm going, folks. But looking at the history of salt a bit, okay, and what it meant 2,000 years ago. To us, salt is a shaker on a table, right? For the most part, for many of us. The salt of the earth is not some cute little saying that you put on a needlepoint or you find in a Hallmark card. That is not what Jesus intended for that phrase, how to be used. Jesus is saying to those people on the mountainside, okay, you guys are blessed. I've gone through these beatitudes. Now here's how you're to live life. Be salty. Okay? And what does that mean? Well, first, I mean, let's take a moment here. First, salt is essential to our health. Now, surprise, surprise, I'm not a doctor of medicine, okay? So take what I'm about to say with a huge grain of, yeah, okay. You know, we all, typically we hear, you know, don't have too much salt in your diet. It's not good for your blood pressure, yada, 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 yada. But salt is essential. With the right proportion of water in your body, salt is essential to help stabilize and regulate blood pressure. It's essential in helping to balance sugar levels within your system. It is essential in the hydroelectric energy that is within all your cells to help them to multiply and be healthy. Okay. It's essential to have salt in your gut for the absorption of food. Salt helps to prevent gout and varicose veins. Okay. It helps to clear lungs and your sinuses. It prevents muscle cramps. It's a natural antihistamine, which I didn't actually know. And without salt, our bones will not be strong. They'll just be mush. Okay? Helps with sleep regulation. Salt's essential. Okay? It helps maintain your sexual drive, your libido. Sea salt has 80 minerals within it that are essential for our body. Now, what happens with the table salt, you know, the salt that we have in our shakers, many of those minerals are taken out. And to make it kind of that powdery consistency, what you have put in it is an aluminum silicate, which physicians and scientists have seen a close connection between too much of that and the onset of Alzheimer's. So stay away from table salt. Use sea salt. But once again, everything I say, take with a grain of salt. Hopefully sea salt. Now, this unassuming mineral, this salt is essential to our survival. It's a mover and it's a shaker. Yes, pun intended. Okay? It's one of the most common minerals on earth. Okay? And was essential in the establishment of human civilization. That's not an overstatement. You know, ocean salt, it's fascinating. I did little facts. But if you took all the salt out of the ocean, it would cover all the land of earth 45 stories high. That's a lot of salt. But salt for most of human history has been difficult to extract from the ocean and from the land. And so it became extremely valuable. And because of its scarcity and our dependence upon it, it has had strategic value really almost since the dawn of time. The first documented war we have documentation of several centuries ago, actually thousands of years ago, was in China. And the war was fought over salt. Yeah. And in fact, that war was in China. And in fact, in China, there was a time when part of your taxes could be paid in salt. So if you've delayed and put off paying your taxes, go to the IRS with a bag of salt. Tell them, this is how it used to be done. It was salt was considered very precious in Jesus' day. The Latin word for salt, sal, which is the root for salarium, which is the word salary. Okay, Roman soldiers in Jesus' day, part of their wages was paid in salt. In fact, in the 6th century, salt in the Sub-Sahara was just as valuable ounce for ounce as gold was. Salt has been essential in the ancient world. It was essential. A major trade commodity. Salt was so precious in Jesus' day that if you accidentally spilt it, like at the dinner table, the belief was that it was Satan behind you, shoving you and pushing you to spill that precious commodity. And what would you do when you spilled that salt? You would take some and do what? Throw it over your shoulder to do what? To blind Satan. Stop it! Right? Fact. Fascinating here. Here is like half the picture of Da Vinci's Lord's Supper, right? Jesus is over here, so he's not in this picture. But here is Judas, right? Now let's just do a quick up close of Judas here. Look at that. Look what he's knocking over. Some salt. Satan is playing on Judas. Bless his heart. Salt is fascinating. Has fascinating chemical properties to it. If you add salt, I know, chemist Steve, once again, take everything I say with it, because I'm not a chemist, a grain of salt. But salt, when added to like meat that has moisture in it, or vegetables, or fish, it draws the water out, right? So rather than me do an experiment up here with you, because it'd take a while and you couldn't really see it, I'm just going to show this little video for like 20 seconds.
We're looking at a clump of salt molecules in tissue that's filled with water. As the water molecules float by, they lock onto the salt and pull it apart. The salt molecules separate and draw the water out of the tissue. Without water, the microbes that cause decay die, and the dried tissue lasts for months or years.
Okay. So the salt molecules draw the water molecules apart. It dries out. Those microbes die that cause decay and rot. And so meat and fish and vegetables would be salted, and they could be preserved for months and for years. This was key to the establishment of civilization. Because in Jesus' world, there wasn't electricity yet, right? Salt was basically the refrigerator. to preserve food so that the people could get from one harvest to the next and have food in between. I mean, today salt is manufactured on a huge scale, but it's essential in making of glass and plastics and textiles and paper. This mineral, wars were once fought over because it was so precious. It's now so common we use millions of tons of it to just de-ice our roads in the winter. Salt literally has saved people and saves food. So, apropos, the word salvation, the first three letters, are the Latin word for salt. Decay and rot, physical decay and rot, and spiritual decay and rot are enemies of life. Salt arrests decay and helps to preserve. And as a result, salt had spiritual significance for the Jews in ancient Israel. Look at these two verses real quick. In Leviticus, season all your grain offerings with salt. An everlasting covenant of salt. Salt was to remind the people symbolically of God's eternal covenant with them, that God preserves his relationship with them. And so salt was used in their offerings very frequently. It was a preservative that reflected the permanence of God's covenant, of God's relationship and love for their people. Now, we often hear people being the salt of the earth. And that kind of means, you know, they're humble, they're honest, they're hardworking, they're down to earth, right? But I think Jesus wants to take it even deeper. That saying you're salt of the earth, you're precious and you're essential. You preserve good and you're called to help purify corruption or the corrupt. Now here's an individual, my love for old movies, but here's an individual, Jimmy Stewart plays a character by the name of Jefferson Smith in the movie Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, right? Came out in 1939. And here, Jefferson Smith is a young senator. He's really green behind the ears, all right? He's just young in Congress right now. And he speaks of preserving what is essential and good and precious in our nation. A new senator in D.C. with high ideals. He wants to start a boys' camp in his home state. And just listen to the words that he has as he reflects upon bringing this bill to the floor of Congress.
That's what's got to be in it.
What?
The Capitol Dome.
On paper?
I want to make that come to life for every boy in this land. Yes, and all light it up like that, too. You see, boys forget what their country means by just reading the land of the free in history books. Then they get to be men, they forget even more. Liberty is too precious a thing to be buried in books, Miss Saunders. Men should hold it up in front of them every single day of their lives and say, I'm free to think and to speak. My ancestors couldn't, I can. And my children will. Boys ought to grow up remembering that. And that, that steering committee or whatever it is, they've got to see it like that. And I know Senator Payne will do all he can to help me because he's a wonderful man, isn't he, Mrs. Saunders? You know, he knew my father very well.
He did?
Yeah. Yeah, we need a lot more like him, his kind of character, his ideals.
Let's get on with this.
Oh, yes. All right.
This camp is going to be out in your state.
About 200 of the most beautiful acres that ever were. You've never been out in that country, have you, Miss Saunders?
No.
I've been over every single foot of it. You could have no idea. You just have to see it for yourself. I don't know. The prairies and wind leaning on the tall grass and lazy streams down in the meadows, angry little midgets of water up in the mountains, cattle moving down the slope against the sun, campfires and snowdrifts. You know, everybody ought to have some of that sometime in his life. My dad had the right idea. He had it all worked out. He used to say to me, son, don't miss the wonders that surround you. Because every tree, every rock, every anthill, every star is filled with the wonders of nature. And he used to say to me, have you ever noticed how grateful you are to see daylight again after coming through a long, dark tunnel? Well, he'd say, always try to see life around you as if you've just come out of a tunnel.
I could watch that whole movie with you right now if you want. I meant to stop it after about 30 seconds. So I was like, you go, Jimmy. Jefferson Smith, in this movie, wants to get back to the basics of what he believed this nation was founded upon. Okay, liberty and freedom and a can-do attitude. Like salt, Senator Jefferson Smith wants to preserve those ideals he believed this nation was built upon. So here are impoverished, desperate people on a mountainside that Jesus is talking to. And he's telling them, you're the salt of the earth. They have it within them to call back the nation of Israel to its ideals, to its dreams, to its basics, to what God wants them to be. And earlier in the Beatitudes, he keeps telling them that the kingdom of heaven is theirs, that they've inherited the kingdom of God. So by saying that they're the salt of the earth, they're to flavor this world with the values of God's kingdom. Go back to the basics. Be like a group of Jefferson Smiths. And go make a difference with those high ideals and those hopes and those dreams. The Hebrew word for salt, chalas, figuratively means prudence, wisdom, good judgment, and common sense. Boy, we can use that, right? Jesus is telling the people, hold on to that prudence. Hold on to decent, common sense. And wisdom. The world so needs it. But then he says this. If salt loses its taste, it's useless. How does it lose its taste? I mean, salt remains salt. It becomes tasteless when it's not shared. By itself, it's useless. It's meant to be shared, like the good news. You know, actually, that Morton Salt girl on the front of your worship bulletin, so cute. But you see, when it rains, it pours. She's always pouring out the salt. And when it rains in this world, when tough times come, you keep sharing the salt. You keep pouring it out. You keep enhancing this world with hopes and ideals and dreams and just some good common sense. You share that good news to help preserve what is good in this world and stop corruption. Now, it's interesting. Who does Jesus then, soon after he says about salt losing its saltiness, who does he begin to refer to in Scripture soon after saying salt is useless if it's not, you know, if it loses its flavor? Who is it that Jesus accuses on more than one occasion in his ministry for lacking good judgment and common sense and wisdom? Pharisees. The Pharisees, bless their hearts, these religious leaders, act like they have their act together. And they had their act together about every bit as much as Lot's wife did, okay? Back in Genesis 19. Let me look at this scripture here. Remember that story about Lot's wife? Yeah. God was about to destroy the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And God says to Lot, who's a nephew of Abraham, yes, the father Abraham, says to Lot and his family, that, guys, you got to leave. But don't look back as I'm destroying Sodom, okay? Don't look back, trust me, and just obey. Life is not about, in this story, about looking back. It's about just moving forward with God. Trusting in God, not in some former life that you had. Well, as we see here in Scripture, Lot's wife looks back, right, to see the destruction of the cities. The story is that basically, in some ways, she's trying to hold on to her former life rather than God. And what happened to Lot's wife? She was turned into what? Pillar of salt, bless her heart. Now, the Hebrew word for pillar, this is important here, is netziv. Which means garrison or sentry that was set to look over or stand guard and protect. You see, the Pharisees were all about holding on to and protecting their way of life, looking over their wealth and their influence and standing guard over it. It's as if You know, you could have all the wealth in the world. You could have ore in that day, all the salt in the world. But without God, you're just a salt lick, like Lot's wife, right? The Pharisees were salt licks, trusting in their lives rather than in God, obeying their wealth and their power and their position rather than God. God is not looking for some good salt licks. God is looking for people who are willing to be the salt of the earth, who will take on the properties of salt, who will stop the world's spiritual decay and preserve that which is good. So how are you doing? You the salt of the earth that Jesus spoke of? Are we the salty disciples that Jesus intends for us to be? To stand up against corruption in this world and offer hope? Well, in Matthew 5, 17, I'll go back there. Yada, yada, yada. Jesus uses some salty language here. It's witty and it's clever. It's down to earth and it's a lot of common sense. This is what he says. And he's kind of connecting, curiously enough, with the Pharisees at this moment. Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter of this law, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus loved the law every bit as much as the Pharisees, saying, you know what, not even the smallest of letter, not the least stroke of a pen should be changed. Now, the smallest letter in Hebrew is a yod, just a little mark like that, okay? It's the smallest of letters. It's the 10th letter in the Hebrew alphabet. And often, in the ancient Hebrew scriptures of the Old Testament, we have two yods together, often pointed to the name of God. Basic, simple, essential. Yod was, as small as this letter was, it was crucial to everything. And needed. The Pharisees would agree, and Jesus would agree. Jesus also, like the Pharisees, agreed that not the smallest of the commandments must be abided by and embraced. Now, there were 613 commandments, okay? And Pharisees often argued over what is the least important commandment, if you will. And it was the commandments. And it's in Deuteronomy 22, I believe, verse 6 and 7. And basically, the commandment is this. If you're walking along a road and you see a nest, it's on the ground or in the tree, and it has a mother bird in it and some eggs or some little birds with mom, do not take mom. You can take the little ones, but leave mom alone, okay? So that you will live long and it may go well with you. This is often argued as perhaps the least of the commandments, but it still must be followed and embraced to enhance life. Jesus and the Pharisees agreed with that. Can't pick and choose. Obey all 613 commandments. Jesus loved the Torah, loved the Word of God. Okay? Believe that it should be obeyed. And Jesus makes a very clear case to the people on that mountainside. I'm not changing anything here. Okay? I'm not abolishing any law. I love the laws of Moses. And a salty disciple must preserve these laws because they're good. But then Jesus kind of walks the edge a bit and he uses some dangerous, salty language. And he says this, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Whoa. That sounds impossible. The Pharisees knew the law inside and out. They memorized the Torah. You know, how can our righteousness exceed them, Jesus? Because the Pharisees have left out one essential element in the law. Love thy neighbor. When Jesus says that their righteousness and our righteousness must exceed the Pharisees, he's actually setting the bar very low. Okay? Pharisees lost their saltiness. They are not sharing the good news. They're focusing on holding on to their reputation, onto their power, onto their wealth. They're focusing more on being a salt lick rather than being the salt of the earth. Well, in this movie, Mrs. Smith Goes to Washington, Senator Jefferson Smith finds himself at one point where he is standing against the political machinery of D.C. that is determined to hold on to its power through greed and graft. But Senator Smith stands his ground as he filibusters, and he reflects what it means to be a salty follower of Jesus. As he fights corruption, and in his own way, you could say, he's attempting to drain the swamp of greed and graft that is in D.C.
Get up there with that lady that's up on top of this Capitol dome, that lady that stands for liberty. Take a look at this country through her eyes if you really want to see something. And you won't just see scenery. You'll see the whole parade of what man's carved out for himself after centuries of fighting. And fighting for something better than just jungle. And so he can stand on his own 2 feet, free and decent, like he was created. No matter what his race, color, or creed. That's what you see. There's no place out there for graft, or greed, or lies, or compromise with human liberties. And that, if that's what the grown-ups have done with this world that was given to them, then we better get those boys' camps started fast and see what the kids can do. And it's not too late. Because this country is bigger than the Taylors, or you, or me, or anything else. Great principles don't get lost once they come to light. They're right here. You just have to see them again.
I guess this is just another lost cause, Mr. Payne. All you people don't know about lost causes. Mr. Payne does. He said once they were the only causes worth fighting for. And he fought for them once. For the only reason any man ever fights for them. Because of just one plain simple rule. Love thy neighbor. And in this world today full of hatred, a man who knows that one rule has a great trust. You know that rule, Mr. Payne. And I loved you for it just as my father did. And you know that you fight for the lost causes harder than for any others. Yes, you even died for them. Like a man we both know, Mr. Payne. You think I'm licked. You all think I'm licked. Well, I'm not licked. And I'm gonna stay right here and fight for this lost cause. Even if this room gets filled with lies like these. And the Taylors and all their armies come marching into this place. Somebody will listen to me.
So how you doing? Are you the salt of the earth that Jesus spoke of? Are we the salty disciples Jesus intends, fighting against corruption, moral rot, and failure, and offering hope? Are we standing up for the lost causes, fighting to preserve values and morals that are a heartbeat of common decency, reflecting the love of neighbor? Do you know anyone who's so salty, laying their life on the line, saying what needs to be said, hoping some point, at some time, someone will hear what's being said? You have it in you to be salty, to stand up for what you believe in, not for your self-interest, but for the common good, to be willing to use, as they say sometimes, just some good, common horse sense. To live in a community where people live and honor each other and value each other and see one another with the love that God sees them with. And even if you're not quite there to be able to see each other with that kind of love, keep trying. And as a church, we need to give our life trying to do that. Trying to be the salt of the earth, enhancing and preserving and holding on to what is good and true and right and moral, and proclaiming God's will be done through love of neighbor. Dare to be so salty so that your righteousness will exceed those in this world who are hell-bent on holding on to their power and their position, who want to be seen and admired like some pillar of salt. Dare to be the salt of the earth, refusing to be silenced in the face of moral corruption. That's the movement Jesus started, and he knew it would cost him his life. Nations have come and go, but that salty like love, oh, that's eternal. That it ain't going anywhere. So today is our day to be the salt of the earth. Today is our day to filibuster like a Jefferson Smith, if you will, and to stand our ground and not give up the floor until we are heard, until that good news resounds across this world. That is our job as disciples. Oh, blessed are you, you salty disciples. Let us pray. Almighty God, if we must filibuster, then may we filibuster. May we stand our ground. May we proclaim your good news. May we truly embrace being salt of the earth. May we claim that identity that you gave to your children on that mountainside. Give us the strength, the purpose, the vision we need to honor your teachings. Empower us. Fill us with that salt so that we may enhance, may preserve, may stand up for what is good and true. The greatest commandment, loving you and our neighbor. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.